Hi, I'm Brian Collins, the head football coach at CW Post College in New York. We are here to talk about defending the wing T. As a basis of defending it, we are an eight-man front. We play the G defense, the eight-man front defense, and the reason we are into this defensive front is specifically to face teams that do run the option, that do run the wing T, that do run power football. Each week, we see a multiple number of offenses, and we wanted to be in a defense that, number one, allowed us to adjust, make adjustments and adjust to these things without moving personnel around. We don't want to be running with motion or bringing people over with motion. We want minimal type of movement so our players have their feet set ready to play football. The flexibility of being the eight-man front is a reason why we do this. We also are in the eight-man front because we want to run to the football and have great pursuit. I think it limits the offensive game plan on what they can do. We also want to be able to attack. In the eight-man front, you're allowed to attack from the outside and the inside, and when you do face the wing T and the option football teams, you don't want to be in a blitz situation very much. And if you are in a blitz situation, there are balanced blitz that can come up and not hurt you and have people running with their back turned towards the football. If we put up an I formation, which we don't see as much I as we used to, but if we were to go over some terminology so you could understand some of the things that we're talking about, we do call them gaps, okay? A, B, C, D gap football. Okay? Now, when we do talk about alignments, we do talk alignments as numbers, okay? We go inside shade would be number one, head up two, outside shade of guard three. Inside shade of the tackle would be a 4-I, head up would be a 4, and the outside shade of the tackle would be a 5, okay? Inside shade of the tight end would be a 7, head up would be a 6, outside shade would be a 9. And so that's how we relate to our different types of techniques and shade on the different linemen. Now, if you were a linebacker, all you would do is to take that number and put a 0 at the end. So if I was an outside shade on the guard, I would be a 30 technique. Okay, our front is set. Our four down linemen, we call the open side end in a 5 technique, the evil. Okay, we call our 1 technique, shading inside of the guard, our nose, our 3 technique is called a tackle, and our inside technique on the tight end, our other defensive end, which is in a 7 technique, is called our SAM. So those are our 4 down linemen. Now, if we were going to talk about what we're looking for in these 4 down linemen, okay, if we took our ends, okay, we would say the quicker pass rushing type of end would be our 5 technique end. He's a guy that, again, could be a running back type at the lower level. He doesn't have to be a big type of kid. We've been fortunate to get good size there. It also has good speed. But our 5 technique could be the lesser of the two. The 7 technique is more of a plugger type guy that's going to face some down blocks and some double teams, so he's got to be a little bit thicker. Now, that doesn't mean to say that we flip-flop our guys. You can flip-flop, okay, to get your matchups. You can play your evil into the boundary and your sand to the field. We, in the past, have just played left-right because they feel comfortable, and if there is a tight end trade, it doesn't really hurt us. They've learned both techniques. Our inside people, our tackles, our nose guard, again, doesn't have to be the big type of guy. He could be a smaller inside interior lineman that's very good quickness, gets off the ball low and runs to the football very well. Okay, our tackle, our 3 technique tackle is going to be a bigger type player. He's going to face a lot more double teams and down schemes, and we need him to be a little bit bigger so he doesn't get washed into the linebackers or down the line of scrimmage. So that would be our front as far as our defensive line. Now, our inside backers, and this is the reason why a lot of them call it a 4-2-5 defense nowadays, but we are still calling it an 8-man front 4-4. Okay, our backer lines up inside of the tackle at 4.5 yards, okay, he's considered a 40-eye player, okay? Inside eye of the tackle at 4.5 yards. Our Mac linebacker is going to be stacking our nose guard. He's going to be in what we call a 10 technique. Now, when we're talking about these two players, okay, the backer, linebacker, could be the smaller type linebacker, the one that can scrape. He is going to be covered up. He doesn't face a lot of one-on-one schemes in the blocking technique. He's more of a scrape type linebacker that many times is untouched. The Mac linebacker is more of your true big physical type linebacker, your downhill type of linebacker that plays against pressing the center techniques and some ISO type looks. Okay, as we moved to our outside linebacker types, we have our strike and what we call our whip. Some people call it a rover. Okay, we call it a whip. They are aligned at 4.5 yards also. Okay, our strikes alignment can be anywhere from 4.5 to 4 to 5 yards off the tight end side. If number two is split, we just have to decide, do we want him 1 yard outside of that split number two receiver, or if he's trying to pull us out of that box area, we feel him pulling us out, we'll take an inside alignment off number two strong. But we can play around with his alignment as the same as the whip. He's usually aligned in the apex of the tackle box and the one weak receiver. These are boundary players. Our whip is a boundary player, okay? And our strike is a field player. We just feel that's a little bit more, it's easier to find one of those guys. It's maybe a little bit more quick. It can cover a number two receiver in man-to-man situations a little bit better, works a little bit better in space. So again, what we're talking about is maybe he's more of a defensive back type, again, a running back type. He could be maybe an inside linebacker type guy. If you can get a defensive back, a safety type, that's ideal, okay? Now, again, he can line up in any type of formation. He's in his hit position now. He could be in a walk position, which is outside. Bang is even further out, okay? Or if we want to get him inside, we'll get him more into a hit type of position for him. Those are our two alignments. Again, the reason we're playing this at our level is that they're running back types. They're the best athletes that we can recruit. And often you could put a running back one, two, three, possibly a fullback here, all right, and something here. So you have guys that can run, good athletes that can run in space and pursue the football, all right, which leads us to our secondary, okay? We have two corners, all right? One of them is definitely a field corner for us. One's a boundary corner. Again, running this defense, you don't need the great defensive back types. It's hard for us, being Division II, to recruit a defensive back out of high school. I think it's important that you see them in person. It's very hard to see them on film when you evaluate them. And often, if you can get a real good one, you're very lucky. So it does limit the number of defensive backs that you do need in your defense. Okay, we have two corners. Again, our field corner and our boundary corner. If you're fortunate to have two great corners, just put them left and right, and which leads us to a free safety. Now, our corners, and I'm going to talk about our base coverage here just for a little bit, and then I'll get back to coverages later, but our base coverage is a robber coverage, which we call cover eight. So our corners' initial alignment is going to be anywhere from 1 yard inside to 2 yards inside and 9 yards deep. Okay, again, 1 yard to 2 yards inside and 9 yards deep. Our free safety, who's really the ninth man in the box in our run support, in our cover eight, our robber coverage, he could be aligned in the B gap to passing strength, and he could be anywhere from 8 yards to 10 yards to if you want to move him back to 12, because people just can't get away with putting him up there early, move him back to 12. All right, we have had him played at 8 yards, very effective. We've moved him back to 12, and we didn't lose his effectiveness. So whichever way you feel comfortable with. Now, that's the overview of the personnel that we're looking for. I would say that if you could get these types of players, you could pretty much plug the same type of player into four or five positions on this defense. Again, this is why we play it, and we've been successful in stopping the run with it. When we talk about defending the wing T, I think the first thing you have to understand is the philosophy. Defending the wing T is a philosophy and not a game plan. You must understand the wing T. That's something your players have to do. The teaching process when defending the wing T is to chalk it. We put it on the blackboard. We talk about it in the meeting room. The second thing is we go out there and we walk it. We talk about all the formations and what they do through those formations. We work the blocking schemes with our players, without the fronts, without our backs in the backfield. I think what you want to do is chalk it, talk it, and walk it, then get out on that practice field and put the line over there with the blocking schemes without the backs. And your players want to understand that the wing T is devised for deception, okay, to slow down defenses. And I think you need to tell your players that, and they need to expect and understand what the wing T is. Now, one thing that was important to us when we are facing wing T is our scouting report. Okay, if you look at their personnel, that will dictate the basic plays that they will run. Is it a big, fast, is a big, strong fullback? Then you're going to see a little bit more of the belly play, the belly fold play. Do they have a fast halfback? Then you might see a little bit more of the sally or a little bit more of the sweep. Is the quarterback equal at running the ball as he is at throwing the ball? Are you going to see a lot of the option game coming back from it? Or are you going to see more of the waggle type of situation where he's just going to be throwing the ball on the run? I think you need to do that. You need to know what kind of personnel you're going to face. I think you need to check the stats for the fullback, the right halfback, the left halfback, who gets the ball the most. Okay, now, when we are defending the wing T, I'll put up a base wing T formation that we see. Okay, to that, we call this formation hawk formation. Okay, the wing T that we see quite often is in this formation. We're starting to see a lot of people taking this and spreading, taking this boy and spreading them out and more of a spread look. And we can go over that in some of the other defenses that apply to it. We want to set our front, okay? We have our one technique, which is an inside shade of the guard. We have our three technique tackle, which is an outside shade of the guard. Okay? What we want to do in the wing T is we want to put our base personnel down, and we want them to learn only one side only. We don't like to flip-flop our guys. If we're preparing for a wing T team, we want our people aligned on one side so they can see and feel comfortable with what reads they're going to see. In this defense, we put our end in a heavy five. Okay? What I mean by a heavy five is he's almost eye to eye. His left inside eye is on the outside eye of that tackle. We want to be nice and heavy. The Sam in our base defense is in a seven technique. Now you need to decide for yourself is if you can move him to a head-up technique, a six technique, that could be a situation where it would help you out a little bit if you're facing a lot of the down schemes on this side and they're running that sweep to your side. But otherwise, if you can survive with your tight end down block in a seven technique, we would prefer to stay in a seven technique. If they split and or flex this tight end, we're going to line up as a ghost seven technique. We're not going to walk out. We're not going to widen our people because they widen their splits. Okay, we're going to line up in ghost techniques where those people would be aligned. Okay, and that's how we set our defensive front. It's how we play versus I formation. It's how we play against spread formations. These are their alignments. They feel comfortable in their alignments. I would say the end is maybe a little bit tighter than he usually is. And you'll see why. If we want to face option football, okay, we want him to be nice and tight so we get a nice, clear read for that inside linebacker. Okay? Now, our inside linebackers in the scheme, okay, what we do is normally we align them in a 40-eye and a 10 technique. Well, in wing T, okay, if we're facing wing T that week, we'll just slide them over to 230 techniques. 230 techniques, all right? Outside of the guards. The reason being is that versus the motion, whichever way one of these guys motion, that's where they'll get to their 40-eye alignment. So we don't want them shifting over too much. We want them playing with their feet set. We want them at 4.5 yards. And again, Don't cheat them up. Those guys get antsy in there. They want to cheat up a little bit, but their 4.5 yards is their best friend. Okay, being deeper allows them to run downhill and trigger and see things better. Okay, our outside linebackers, when they are aligned on wings, they will be in an up technique. Okay, so if we have our whip, okay, right, he'd be 1 yard outside and in his up technique. Okay, our strike linebacker, our outside linebacker, same way, will be outside 1 yard, okay, and he'll be in his up technique. The reason being that they're in their up look, okay, usually they're back at 4.5 yards of the linebacker, but we move them up versus wing T because we want them to be prepared if there's a down block to be able to force that issue right now, okay, rather than waiting on the ball. Okay, if one of their wings goes in motion, then they'll back off to 4.5 yards and get their cross reads and look for something coming back. Okay, so when they have a wing to their side, they're in their up look. When the wing goes in motion, they kick back to their 4.5 yards so that they can see a little bit better versus something coming back, a sally play. Okay. Our defensive secondary. Okay, our corners will be 1x9 inside leverage of number one. We count outside in. So that's one, that's two, that's three, that's one, that's two. Okay, we'll go over this in 1 second. Okay, so the corners are lined up. Okay. Our free safety. Again, in RG football, he's a run support player. He's a cover eight in our robber coverage. He's cover eight. He's usually aligned in the B gap to passing strength. Now, they're a little bit balanced here. We'd probably say we'll put him here, the free safety. We'll dictate this as passing strength. Or we would dictate this as passing strength if this was a big tight end that was a big time receiver for them based on the numbers. Okay. What we'll do versus wing T, we won't let him favor one side. We'll put him right in the middle of the formation at 12 yards. Okay, so he, again, can alter his alignment with any type of movement. Okay, so we'll get our players. Okay, we'll talk about this. We'll put it on the board for them. We'll go over the formation that they'll see. Okay, this is a formation that they'll often start in. Okay, we'll chalk it, we'll talk it, we'll walk it. We'll go out on the practice field. We'll put them in this formation. Okay, then we'll have them walk through the plays without the football. Many times on the first day that we're preparing for a wing T football team, we won't even use a football. Okay, we just don't want them to be running where they think the football is. We want them to play their responsibility. You take away the football that first day of practice and tell them just make the plays to your side that you're supposed to make. Follow your reads, follow your rules, and they'll get an understanding of, hey, you know, the coach wants me to play this responsibility. We're not even playing with a football. We're going to go through our reads, and we're going to play that way. I think then you have to talk about putting your players. The hardest thing that we see in a college level is getting our scout team to run this. So if you have a group of players, if you're a high school coach and you take your second string unit, give them some extra time just to run through the base plays that you want them to run to. Let them get an understanding of it. At our level, in the college level, we do have a scout team. Those scout team players, I mean, during meeting time, during walkthrough, they're with one of our position coaches going through all the plays that we're going to run that day throughout practice. I think then the next thing you have to do is you're going to teach by series. Okay? If we want the sweep series, okay, let's go over the fullback trap, let's go over the sweep, let's go over the waggle pass, the freeze option, and the crisscross counter. If we're going to teach the belly series, if they're going to line up in two back, put him in two back, okay, and run the belly iso series, let's work on those series, okay, and then give them the series away from the set of backs that they can run. Just teach them the progression in the series. This is something that if you don't face it every week, maybe when you're away at camp during the summer, you want to spend the last day or 2 days just having your defensing the wing T philosophy in there. Again, it's not you don't want it to be a game plan. You want to have it in already. You want to be a part of your defense so that they're not altering too much and that they can play effective defensive football. Okay, our defensive line, okay, their reads are normal. They don't change from week to week, again, with the exception of maybe our five technique playing a little bit tighter and squeezing that tackle, okay, to show a clearer picture to the MAC, and maybe our Sam playing a little bit more of a six technique, but he's still responsible for C-gap, their responsibilities don't change much during this preparation. The number one reads for the D-line is their man on. Okay, their number two read is the near back. Okay, number three, ball inside. Now versus wing T, you might not get to the near back as much as the ball inside, but what we're talking about is man on. Okay, now when we talk man on, we're talking about two things. Okay, we're talking about visual keys and pressure keys. Visual and pressure. What I mean by this, defensive end, your visual key is the man you're shading. Okay, so that's my visual key. Your pressure key in this instance would be the back. Okay, that would be your pressure key. All right, you're not reading it, you're just feeling that. Okay, you're seeing this block, you're reacting to that block. If I'm a nose guard in a one technique, that's my visual key. Okay, the center is my pressure key. I'm watching the nose guard, I'm reading, reacting. Okay, I'm getting off the ball, I'm reacting to what he's doing, and I'm feeling what the center is doing to me. I'm a three technique tackle, my visual key is that guard, my pressure key happens to be that tackle. And with the Sam, it's the same as the five technique. We don't change it. Even though he's aligned on this man, his visual key happens to be that. Okay? And the pressure key becomes the tight end. Okay? As we react to our blocks, okay, we see the near back to the ball inside. If I'm an end, okay, if I'm getting drive blocked, okay, I'm just going to squeeze and compress that drive block. If I'm getting a down block, I'm bending, picking up the near back, okay, which could be the fullback or the ball inside, certainly could be the pulling lineman in the wing T sense. Okay? All these double teams, okay, if I'm a nose guard, okay, and I'm getting base blocked, well, I'm going through the shoulder of that base block, I'm going through the front of it and out the back. That's how we play the drive block in the nose guard. If we're getting a double type, double team, I'm going to defeat that visual key. I'm going to lock out, I'm going to play that like a drive block, I'm going to turn my butt towards the center, okay, towards my pressure key, and try to split that double team, all the while keeping that center from getting an easy read onto that MAC linebacker. Okay, if I'm getting some kind of scoop, you know, in the wing T, they don't really do as much. Sometimes we start and see some zone blocking with some of the wing T plays. It's not true wing T. Okay, if we're getting some kind of combo block, a reach, again, I'm defeating the reach block by my visual key, turning my butt towards my pressure key and trying to split it that way, all the while making it tough for him to chip off onto the MAC linebacker. Okay, if I get any type of inside pull, which you will get very much versus the wing T, any type of inside pull, how will I play this back block by the center? Okay, that's key in the pressure. If he's coming real solid, just a short, solid step, many times we'll just ask him to compress that. Just compress that center right back in the hole, because you do have gaps taken by the MAC linebacker. You don't want him sometimes playing across the face. But if you have a center that takes a real shallow step to try to cut you off, well, we give them the freedom to work across the face. He just has to play opposite the nose guard. If we get a center that comes off and tries to really cut you out, just try to shield you from the play, many times we'll say, make the play. Go rip behind him and go chase the ball and make the play. Any type of outside pull, in the wing T to a tackle, where you get an outside pull, you're immediately going to the near back. If the near back is coming downhill, that fullback's coming downhill, you've got an outside pull, and this guy's coming downhill now, you know you're getting influence trapped. Okay, what we'll do on an outside pull, check the near back, collapse inside. If you're getting some kind of sweep, then you know this is our job first. Our tackles are not supposed to be making plays on any type of sweep. They're to make plays on the fullback trap, all right? The belly fold, the fullback trap. If they're making plays on a sweep, it's only because we've turned it inside and they're taking a cutback angle, all right? We are never going to follow an outside pull. We're going to read that near back and collapse the inside. Tackle has the same exact reads as the nose guard. You play that drive block through the shoulder and out the back. Any type of reach scheme you get, okay, defend the reach block. Any type of double team we get, beat your visual key, turn your butt, work your way through your pressure key. Make it hard for him to come off down to the backside linebacker on any type of sweep. Okay, any type of outside pull. Outside pull. Now, that's a big play because in the wing T, we get a lot of that belly fold. They'll put him in motion on this nice wide belly fold. Okay, you've got to differentiate. Is it a belly fold? Is it a trap? Tough thing for you guys to do here. Well, we say, we teach them again, you get an outside pull. Okay, go to your near back. If he's midlining it, I'm thinking I got to stop trap. It's either the trap or it's the sweep. I'm not going to make a play on a sweep. I got to make a play on a trap. Okay, that midline is going to tell you what to do. So you see an outside pull, fullback midline, collapse it, play the trap. You get an outside pull, and you see that fullback's path is a little bit wider, then you know it's going for the belly fold. You're going to feel your pressure key right now. Okay? You're going to feel that pressure. That's a belly fold, and you're going to fight the pressure. But I think you're not going to know if it's trap or belly fold unless you're reading the near back's angle. Okay? Midline, we're thinking trap. Outside, we're thinking belly fold. Okay? Any type of down play, we're bending and breaking up the trap that way. Those are the type of blocks we'll see from that three technique. If I'm a seven technique and I get a down block by that tackle, I'm bending. That's my visual key. Okay, I don't care if this tight end's blocking me down. I don't care if they're doubling me onto the backside linebacker. If I get a down block, I'm starting to bend, and I'm going to take on, I may get near back, I might not. I might get ball inside, which means I'm getting some kind of pull by pulling lineman. It might be the sweep series. Okay? My job is not to wrong arm it. Okay, people say, well, I'm wrong arm it. Wrong arming to us is we're selling out our player. We're telling you to wrong arm it, but don't make the play. We do want him to attack it inside out, okay, but we want to hit it square up, right, via the neck, hit it via the neck, and then plant your foot and bring them upwards. So if we're getting some kind of pull, I'm going to hit it and get it upfield and really make that sweep bounce, okay, or counter, whatever we're running there, okay? If I get any type of double, again, I'm going to beat my visual key, compress my visual key, and turn my butt towards my pressure key, not allowing him to get down an easy release onto my inside linebacker, all right? Basically, we get the same exact reads. We don't have to do too many things. These guys are the same reads. We're going to work on our doubles. We're going to work on our inside pulls. We're going to work on our outside pulls by the tackles. Our defensive ends, they're going to work on base blocks. They're going to work on getting down and bending and blowing up people. Okay, and they're going to work on, you know, a little bit of a down block, you know, situation where they can work the way upfield and get more pressure. Okay, our inside linebackers. Inside linebacker play. Again, they're at 4 yards. If they were to motion, okay, they're at 4.5 yards. If they were to motion, this person motion back, okay, they would trigger half a step over during the motion. So he'd go from a 30 technique into a 10 technique. He'd go from a 30 technique to a 40-eye technique. Okay, again, they're both lined up in 30 techniques, outside shades of the guard. Wherever the motion comes from, they would just trigger over half a shade. Okay, don't ever underestimate the advantage of half a shade. It means being blocked and not being blocked. That's what we tell our players. Two things. Number one, don't get too close and press the football. You're going to get caught in all kinds of down blocks and all that wash inside. You're not going to see things clearly. Stay at 4.5 yards. It is your friend. Number two is don't ever underestimate that little trigger step. Okay, whatever trigger step, what comes after that trigger step is just as important, but you got to make that trigger step. Now, most of our guys up front, okay, what they will be reading, they'll know the scheme, they'll know the coverages, okay, they will read guards to the backfield. That'll read that whole triangle, okay? Their responsibility, okay, is to fill open window scrape closed doors. All right, that's their rule. Any defense that we teach, okay, we always give the linebackers the freedom. You're a linebacker, okay? You know, that's a position where, you know, you can't lose. Can't lose at that position. If you're a defensive lineman and this wing T team rushes for 500 yards, they're going to get yelled at. And if you're playing a wing T defense and they throw four touchdown passes on the waggles, those secondary guys are going to get ripped. You're not going to lose as an inside linebacker, okay? We give them the freedom to make plays. Fill open windows. So if it's open, fill it. If it's closed, scrape. Okay, those linebackers, okay, that's the rule they live by. Okay, fill open windows, scrape closed doors. If I'm playing an I formation, that's what they're doing. Filling open windows and scraping the closed doors. Okay, if we're playing one back, if it opens up, I'm filling it. If it's closed, I'm going to scrape over the top of it. So they do the same thing during the wing T. They just have more of awareness of where their offensive guards are and where the pull calls are. Okay? Now, once we get the motion and they trigger, okay, if they see any type of fullback lane, this is what they're going to redirect. Okay, we get motion. We go based upon flow of the fullback, always knowing what the guards are doing. Okay, if I get fullback flow to my side, I'm triggering. I know I'm a 91 player. Okay, I'm a D-gap player. Okay, if I get flow this way, fullback stepping this way, the MAC, you know that you're a one-gap player. Okay, the pressure is on you to always make your pull calls with the guards, and they're only versus inside pulls. Let that linebacker know pull call. When I am a linebacker and I give a pull call, I then can follow and run through. Okay, we allow them to run through the gap. If I'm a linebacker and I'm getting a pull call, I immediately turn my head to the outside. Okay, somebody is going to down block me. And we will allow them also to come underneath those down blocks. Too often, okay, now that's the problem also. Too often, you let your linebackers try to play over the top. Okay, some of those guys, they cheat up, they hop up, and they're at 3 yards on a snap of the ball. They get down blocks, they're trying to get over the top of them, and they can't make a play. All right, we want them to be at 4.5 yards. They see motion, they trigger, they see the snap of the ball, they see flow, they hear a pull call, their head turns right to the outside so that they can play these down blocks, defeat these down blocks, get over top of them. All of our defensive linemen are pinching and bending and making things bounce to the outside. They're going to pick up the scrape techniques. All right, they're not responsible for anything coming back. If they're running this type of motion and they are going to run Sally, he's going to hit it right in that A-gap, okay? Their responsibility for the run, we get motion from this side, and we're getting fullback flow that way. The MAC is a 31 player unless we're getting a down block and our end's bending, then he's going to be a D-gap player. Okay, so flow to him, he's a B-gap, unless his under key, that's our linebacker reads. Number one, flow. Number two, under keys. Who are their under keys? In the wing T sense, offensive guards and my defensive line. Those are my under keys. First, are their guards pulling? Second, how's my defensive line reacting to it? And it's all on the run, and that's why they're at 4.5 yards. Okay? So if I get flow this way, I know I'm a B-gap player, but let's say they're running some type of full block. I'm getting down. I know my end is bending, and I'm going to trip over his heels. Trigger, step on his heels, keep it nice and tight on a scrape technique inside out of that running back. Okay? These are inside-out players. Inside-out players. Okay, the backside linebacker is always responsible for the trap. The playside linebacker is responsible for being underneath those guards and any of the sweep and bouncing it outside to the outside linebackers. Okay, we are in cover 8, which is a robber coverage. Okay, if there does happen to be a pass, one thing we allow our linebackers to do, in wing T, any type of play action pass, okay, a belly pass, Okay, a dive pass. The linebacker to that side is going. Okay, we don't blitz much in the wing T. We kind of sit back, but depending on the play action pass that they're running, it will turn into a blitz because we're going to get the play action linebacker going. The backside will overlap and take his responsibility. I'll get into the coverage part after I get into the run part of it. Our outside linebackers, first of all, if there's a wing to your side, you're in the up technique. They're reading lane of ball. What I mean by lane of ball is the quarterback. Quarterback. I think what they've got to be able to see is that quarterback. At least their line of vision. If I'm reading lane of ball and quarterback, what I mean by this is the QB. If he's on the line of scrimmage, whether he reverses or comes out right away, that's ball in the one lane. Okay? Ball in the two lane, not too sure. Could be run or pass. This is run for us. Ball in the three lane, that's a pass. Okay, now obviously versus wing T, we won't see as much as one or the other. We'll mostly see one and two lane. We won't see much drop back pass. Okay, so they either see number one, lane of ball in the one lane, they think that's run, they get into their run responsibilities. If it's two, they're sitting for a second, they're going to go to their next read, which is number two. Okay, now on the tight end wing side, if I am an outside linebacker, I'm reading it a little bit different. You see, the corners are reading this is number one and this is number two. Okay? But on this side, if I'm an outside linebacker, I read this as number two and this is number one. Okay, on this side, obviously, it's one and two here. Okay? There's reasons for that. I want the strong safety reading this boy rather than that. So I don't call it one and two on this side. We'll go two to one on that side. That's the only difference for them throughout the week. And it's an easy thing because they want to be reading that wing anyway. So let them read them. Okay? So I'm reading lane of ball. Where's that quarterback? Is he coming down the line of scrimmage? Is he reverse pivoting? And what is number two doing? Okay? At some point, though, I think a little bit different than in the past, I think they do have to read offensive linemen. And they don't do that during the season versus other offenses. And it's not a real difficult thing. What I mean offensive guard is I'm just looking at kind of ball inside. If that there's two principles based upon wing T, okay? When the quarterback opens, do I see his face? Is this first thing his face mask? Okay, or is it his back? I just tell the outside linebackers this for help, okay? If you open up, if you see the quarterback and he opens with his face and you see guards pulling towards you, that's waggle pass. Okay, that's waggle pass. So you can take it any which way you want. You're probably going to have number two to the flat. Sometimes you say, you know, let's take this lane of ball out of the picture altogether and let him read number two. We've done that in the past. But I just wanted to give him two helps. If you see a quarterback face open up towards you and you see some color coming towards you, pulling towards you, that's going to be waggle pass. If the quarterback shows you his back and you see guards pulling towards you, that's a sweep right now. You can force it right now, get ready to force it. Here comes the big boys to block you, get ready to force it. So they have a face back read into this. All right, lane of ball, quarterback, is he opening it with his face or he's giving me his back? Okay, again, I'll say it one more time. Okay, I'm the strong safety to that side. Okay, if I open this way, I'm giving him face. And guards are pulling, it's waggle. Okay, he's going to fake everything. He's going to fake the pass and then go to the waggle. If I open up this way and show him back, the sweep is coming. It just helps him a little bit more to get that force angle and that sweep so that they're not getting width. They're kind of collapsing it down a little bit faster. That might be a little confusing for you guys. Maybe they can't pick it up that fast. Then go right to number two. Just let him read number two. Okay, you won't be wrong. Now, If number two goes in motion, they kick back to 4.5 yards, and they're going to look for something coming back, a sally play. Okay? So if they go in motion, I'm actually kicking back, and I'm looking back at that number two. Okay? If this guy goes in motion, I'm kicking back, and I'm looking at this number two. That's their rule. Okay? Now, I'm reading number two. If he stays on the line of scrimmage and he tries to block me or steps towards me, he's mine. That's my guy. Okay? Maybe he's arc releasing and running a pattern. Maybe he's coming out to block me. I'm going to attack him and grab onto him and keep outside leverage. If he's coming to block me, I'm going to attack his outside hip. If he goes down to block, I am forcing this play right now. That's their number one job, is to force. Now, don't let them sit there and tell you, coach, I contained that sweep. I turned it back inside. You have to tell them to force the issue. I want a force technique, not a contain, outside linebacker. Okay? I want to force it. I want to hit it deep. And they can't be wrong if it's that. If he's going to hit it that deep and allow the course of the ball to alter so that the free safety can rally to it and the corner can rally to it, he's done his job. Okay? I'd rather have him hit it here and have things bouncing out to him, then come to the line of scrimmage and get that alley created and offensive lineman running through there and making big plays. So he's a force player. He's coming right now. Okay, any type of down block. Okay, anything away, he's going to sit back. Get back to your 4.5 yards. Now, once the motion is going away and they're back at 4.5 yards, they go back to a 5-yard fence roll. Okay? Once their motion went away, they kick back to 4.5 yards. Now they're at the 5-yard fence roll. What that means is this. They can come back and they can't do this back on the ball. Okay? They must come around this fence to make a play. Too often, those guys, they attack that fence. All right? The play went away. They're coming downhill. They run Sally. They're not in the situation they should be in. It's a big play. All right? Motion goes away, get back to your 4.5 yards, read opposite number two, and then you fold in over the fence. That gives them a great angle to see the opening to make the play against a Sally or counter crisscross. Okay, it also keeps them back there. If they're going to run some type of outside play or outside reverse, they're in a situation where they're seeing things coming back. They're not in a rush to bite up in here. They know they have to come inside and fold over that 5-yard fence rule so that if anything comes back and busts to the outside, they can rally without losing outside leverage. Okay, big point with our outside linebackers. Okay, that's basically their deal. Okay, again, we'll get into cover 8. Okay, that's the coverage we'll be in. And in cover 8, their normal cover 8 rules is reading number 2 anyway. Okay, and if number 2 goes out, he's there. It's man to man. If number 2 goes in, he just gets depth and look for help on number 1, anything to the flat. Okay, if number 2 runs vertical, okay, again, he's going to get wide and look for anything coming out into the flat, the fullback coming into the flat, or any type of crossing route all the way across the field. All right, so those are his reads in cover 8. Normal reads for cover 2 stay the same. Again, 2 comes out, man to man. 2 comes out, man to man. 2 goes vertical, get underneath number 1. Okay? 2 goes in, get underneath number 1. Look for something coming out into the flat. Okay? That's the outside linebacker rules. Free safety. Okay? He's lined up, splitting the two widest. Okay? If we get any type of motion, when we get motion from one of these guys, okay, our free safety is going to work to the B gap to where the motion is. Okay, so if he's going here at a motion, he's going to work his way over that B gap. Okay, we just change his strength. Okay, if he goes this way, okay, then he's going to work to the B gap on this side. Okay, now again, he's in charge. He's our quarterback. We are in cover 8. Okay, cover 8. What cover 8 means to these people here? Okay, let's just go over coverage while we're on the defensive backs. Okay, our corners are reading. Okay, number 1. Again, in this case, the tight end's number 1. We came here as number 1, him is number 2. Okay? He's number 1, him is number 2, as for a corner. Okay, and for outside linebackers. Our corners are deep half players in cover 8. They're reading number 1 and not allowing number 1 to run a post pattern. Okay, that's their first thing. They're deep half defenders. Okay? So if there is no motion, okay, our corners are deep half defenders. If they lined up in this, our hawk formation, and they did not motion, and they ran 4 wides, okay, straight drop back, we'd be in cover 8. These guys would be 2 deep half defenders, not allowing number 1 to run the post pattern. Okay? If they run the post corner, then we're going to spend a lot of time maintaining our inside leverage, take away the post, He breaks to the post corner, boom, speed turn, okay, whip that arm around, dig that chin into your shoulder, and play that post corner out. Okay, very hard. You know, I don't think they'd be running wing T and throwing post corners. Okay, just a different type of quarterback. All right, but you know, we're going to defend that. That's the hardest throw for this quarterback to make, is that post corner, and that's the one route we're going to work on. We'll do a lot of speed turns with them. But we're not, by alignment alone, we're going to take away the deep post pattern. Okay? That's cover 8 for the corners. I've got number 1, communicate all the routes, play deep half. Versus run support, I am a vice player. Vice player. Our free safety, okay, in cover 8, he's responsible for too strong. Okay? That's where he's going to read, too strong. Now, let's say there's no motion here. They've come out, they haven't motioned, okay? We would make possibly a rip call depending on the leading receiver again, who's the leading threat, who's a bigger threat, okay? We would call that a rip call, and he'd be responsible for 2 vertical on a pass play, okay? Again, though, you're in wing T. We don't see much of this. If they're going to go on verticals, we'll have it covered, though. He would be responsible for 2 vertical in a wing T game. All right, if they came out in hawk formation and just tried to pass out of it. Okay? If 2 dragged, okay, some type of bootleg, he'd probably be responsible for 2 dragging. That would be a waggle or a bootleg. Okay? If 2 went out, he'd rob number 1. Okay? Our outside linebackers we talked about being responsible, their reads for number 2. If 2 is out, he's theirs man to man. If 2 is vertical, they're underneath number 1. If 2 goes across, you get underneath number 1, look for something coming to the flat. The MAC linebackers are basically hook curl players. In this situation, though, this backer, if this tight end released, he would have to help out and try to run with this, and the corner would be over the top. Okay, that would be cover 8. But what you'll see is based upon motion, when we talk about coverage, is based upon motion, we will be in great situations to defend based on those principles. If you lined up in 4 wides and we tried to play cover 8, excuse me, it wouldn't be a great situation for us, okay? But you're not. You're in a wing T formation. You're going to go in motion. We're going to check our coverages, and our coverages work out very well. Now, our free safety's responsibility, okay? Again, he's reading motion. If motion goes to that side, number 2 strong becomes his read. If he's blocking, he is an alley fill player all the way. Okay? So he's going to fit either way. If 2 went in motion here, he's reading number 2. If he's blocking, okay, he's an alley fill player between the backer and the strike. Number 2 goes in motion this way, he's an alley fill player between the MAC and the whip. Now he's going to fit. He's going to fit opposite these. If these guys are doing a tremendous job and really forcing the issue, making it bounce, then he'll just not be an alley fill. He'll just overlap and run to the rally to the outside play. So his read, he's alley fill, but he's fitting off of what the whip and the striker are doing. Now, to get into the coverage part of this defense, and what our secret is. Okay, we've already talked about the run support, but let's talk about some of the different motions. Let's say we're getting motion from this side to the wing. Okay, he's motioning to Brown, or he's shifting, or everything else. Okay, once he's motioned or shifted there, he's going to work his way to B-gap. We are now cover 8. Cover 8. Okay? What plays do they run off of the cover 8? Well, you know, I'm talking not the run plays, the belly fold and the sweep. I'm not talking about. I'm just talking about pass plays. Okay? Get something across, something to the flat. Okay. The strike is reading 1 and 2. The strike has number 2. He runs out. The strike's out on number 2. It's man to man. Okay? The corner reads this as number 1. He's always inside number 1. He stays inside number 1. He breaks the post pattern. He plays the post pattern. Now, the free safety, We're in cover eight. We're in cover eight. He's the only guy. He reads this as one and two. And his role is two vertical is mine. So there goes two vertical. He's jumping on that two, so he's going to get underneath that. We have that man-to-man double covered here, double covered here. Okay, the backer is getting play action. He's going to go. The Mac's going to overlap. Okay. I would think they're not going three to the flat. If they do go three to the flat, okay, then the Mac will take that fullback into the flat. Okay, but nobody would be blocking your Sam in that case. Okay, that would be the play, the belly fold play, the belly pass play that we see in cover eight. Okay, most of the routes that you'll see, again, when they motion to the wing, if it's that side, we're being cover eight. If they motion to that side and run the waggle, and motion this way, but run the waggle, okay, once he motioned to wing, a wing set, brown wing, okay, we've stayed cover eight, the corner stays with that route, this corner stays on that route, the free safety takes the drag, okay, that's responsibility number two, okay, the whip will sink for the flat route, which would be the fullback coming to it, the Mac is a play side linebacker, always secondary contains, and we'll bracket and run and trail behind that route. So we'll have two on that tight end drag, which is the one they like to see anyway. So we always have two guys on the route that they wanted to see versus a wing set. When they ran the belly pass to the wing side, we had two people on that post corner, okay, and we had the flat covered. When they ran from the wing set, go the other way, run the waggle pass, they like to hit this tight end formation. We've got two on that side with pressure in his face. An outside linebacker sitting there in man-to-man. So we've covered everything that they want to the pass routes that they want to see to the wing side. Now let me go to the slot side and show what we do to the slot side and how that fits into our wing T pass defense. All right, he goes in motion. Okay? If this wing goes in motion to a slot side, remember, he goes to the B gap that way, we will not run cover eight to that side. Simply, we check eight cloud. Okay, now this guy becomes a flat player, flat defender. He's a seam player. He's a deep half player. He's a deep half player. Everybody else is the same as in cover eight. All right, so if they want to run any of the routes in the option game, then we're fine there. Okay, let's talk a second about option, because you will see option. Okay, the way we defend option when they motion to the slot side and we check cloud is we play our game with the end of the Mac. That's a natural X. Depending on how they block it is how we defend it. If they want to base block it, then he'll take Q under, quarterback under, and he'll run and take the dive, open window. If they want to down block it, this is why he's tight again, because when he's tight and he tries to down block, that's a nice quick read. If they want to down block it, now he'll take dive and he'll trigger at his 4.5 yards and play quarterback under. Nice and neat. Depending on how they block, it's how you defend it. The seam player, the whip, okay, he's got quarterback over. So you've got two guys on this quarterback. And of course, the corner, he's a flat defender, he's got pitch. All right, so we've got a great situation in the option. We got the dive taken care of. We got the two people on quarterback. We got the pitch. We got over the top. If they want a dive pass, okay, dive pass. All right, again, what we talked about is the linebacker to play action pass is going to keep going. So that turns into a blitz type of situation. We're going to play cloud coverage. All right, he's at 6.5 yards. A cloud. Outside, he moves from his 9. We get motion, check cloud, cloud, cloud. He checks over 2 steps. He goes up and over. Outside, He plays his cloud coverage. Great cloud technique. What is cloud technique? Following number one with your feet, seeing what number two is doing. Okay, so we have this covered along with this backside corner to help out on any type of post pattern. And this strike is just going to sink and help out on tight end vertical or any type of throwback. And that we have pressure in his face. It's dive option pass. Okay, any type of pass game is now shut down because your cloud responsibility as well as your option game is taken care of because you have two people on the queue and one person on the pitch, and we're in a good situation over there. All right, so you're just taking care of all pass and all option by just checking a simple cloud check, which moves these two guys over a little. All right, and when he went in motion, he comes back, he goes into 1x9 inside that tight end. And our linebackers shade over half a technique to a 40 and a 10. Okay, now that's the basis of our defense, okay? If we're seeing that hawk formation, we want to align in something, you may choose to align in cover 3 to be safe, and then they motion, you check to cover 8 versus a wing side, which is a robber coverage, or you check versus they motion to a slot side, you check to 8 cloud. Either way, your option is taken care of. The one thing I will go over quickly is any type of option to the wing side is the one-way option we didn't talk about. And we'll clean that up and see what that option looks like. Okay, we have, you know, we talked about the belly fold, we talked about a sweep. If we get any type of option, triple option, okay, to this side, remember, he went in motion. What do we call? To this side, we're going cover 8. We're going to cover 8. He goes in motion, we trigger to a 40-yard, we trigger to a 10. He triggers the B-gap. Okay, he's off the line of scrimmage. Okay, here they come option. Depending on how they block it is what these two guys are doing. If he goes down in any way, he's bending right now for a dive. He's over the top for quarterback. Now, I understand you've got a block, you know, if he's a 6 technique, you've got that block angle. But again, he's quarterback under. He just has to be a presence. He knows to look outside, play quarterback under. We always have 2 on the quarterback. You have just called cover 8. Your read is this tight end. This tight end's blocking. I'm coming up, and I've got quarterback over. Okay? Dive, quarterback under, quarterback over, and I've got pitch. Got that extra play to play any dive pass. All right, so that's how we defend the option. You know, don't give them calls. Don't say you got a 1 and get it, you got a 2 and get it, you got a 3 and get it. Let them play football. Every time you put in a coverage, you put in your option responsibility. Our ends always know, if I get a down block, I'm bending. So if they run option and I get a down block, I've got dive. They know you've got a base block. I'm going to compress that. I've got quarterback. The linebackers know, if it's closed, I'm scraping for quarterback. If it's open, I've got dive. Our outside linebackers know they have pitch. Okay, they have pitch. Now, if they do have a blocking scheme that happens to give you trouble here, you know, this is a given. This guy might get chipped off and hard for him to get the quarterback, and they might be sending him on the free safety. Now, if you see that happening, your coaches are seeing that happen, you're saying, coach, that wing is blocking our free safety. Nobody's really on the quarterback. He's coming for pitch. These two guys have outside blocks that they're getting blocked on. All right, now you just exchange it. Now you just exchange it. Okay? Let him go for the QB. As soon as he gets that down block, he'll come for the QB on option. On option, okay? Now he'll come up, it's almost like a crack, he'll play pitch, okay? And you can send him to stay on that man-to-man. Or, if you feel safer with saying, hey, now you don't have quarterback, you can just keep going to pitch now and you can leave him back as a deep defender, that's an adjustment you can make, all right? But you always have answers based on their blocking schemes on what they're doing because you know how the defense reacts to those blocks. All right, here we are in a hawk formation. Okay, we have the wing. We have our outside linebackers in an up look. Okay, we are in cover 8. We have our normal heavy. You know, we might be a 6 technique here. Sometimes we don't play a 6 technique. If he can dominate, which we feel we win that battle, better put him at 6 and still control C gap. We have our 3 technique, our 1 technique, and our heavy 5. You can see how he's almost head up on that. We have our linebackers in a 4.5 yard range, and our 2 outside linebackers both have wings that they feel are up in their side, so they're in their up look. Our corners are 1x9 inside number 1, and our free safety is right in the middle of both of them. depending on where the motion goes. If this person were to motion to the wing side, again, we said we would go cover eight to that. If this person came in motion and we would be in eight cloud to this side. Now, I think in this play, he's going to zip across motion. So we're going to go eight cloud. You'll see our corner come up. This man will go back, and our free safety will cheat over a little bit, and we'll play cloud coverage. All right, you can see the corner down here. We're now in cloud coverage. He wants to press. Okay, he has a great situation of seeing number one go across, and now he sees number two to flat, so he's a flat defender. I think our outside linebacker in a bunch situation does a great job of being in the seam. He's a seam deflector. He's flat, he's seam. We got our safety over the top. Our backside corner is deep, and our whip is going to sink with any of that. Our inside linebackers do a good job of the converge. So there you have a case of being in cover eight, with waiting for the motion, getting to eight cloud, and being able to cover a drop back pass ball in three lane very, very nicely. All right, here we are. We're in Hawk again. This is a good view. You can see it. We have a seven technique. It could be a six, kind of heavy, three, a one, and a heavy five. We have our linebackers in their up position because they both have wings. Our corner is 1x9 off of number one, which he considers that number one. Okay, our free safety is in the middle of both of them. Our corner up top's inside leverage. Remember, if this guy goes in motion, okay, we're going to check cloud. If this boy goes in motion, we're going to check state cover eight. Okay, we're going to play option. I believe this is an option play. Goes in motion. We're in eight cloud. You can see our free safety, check eight, shuffles over. Our corner comes up, plays cloud. This linebacker gets motion away, steps back. All right, we got option. Now we get a down block, but you can see he is so tight that he can't block that play side linebacker. And now what they're starting to do is put him on the play side linebacker. That's okay. We've got two on the quarterback. He's really on dive, but there is no dive. It's load option. Okay, so we got two on the quarterback with a guy on the quarterback right away to pitch. And he's on pitch. Linebacker does a great job of avoiding blocks, running through. Make him pitch early, we rally to it. Great defense. We felt they wanted to spread us out here, okay? We didn't want to be cover three. We felt we wouldn't have a good situation for four verticals. So what we do is when they're in this set, we call this an A set, okay? Same principle applies. We would be orange match versus this. That's man free. Corners a man on number one. We have our linebackers, man-to-man, four linebackers responsible for these three with a free safety. Now, if they go vertical, our outside linebackers would be responsible for the vertical, funnel it towards the free safety. And our two inside linebackers would have the back. If they went out, obviously our outside linebackers take them. So this put us in a good situation that if they wanted to throw four verticals out of this formation, we'd have man, 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 two guys on the halfback and a free safety. If either one of them motions, we just check cover eight. And now we're out of that situation. Now here they stayed in four wides. You can see our outside linebackers taking it and bracketing it. And then we get a good pass play. That's an answer for four wides. Here's the option we talked about. Okay, they're in their Hawk formation. Now this is option to the wing side. He goes in motion, we stay cover eight. Okay, he would drop back, he'd go to B gap, and we play cover eight defense. If it's option, he would have pitch. These two would have quarterback or dive, depending on how they blocked it, and he would have quarterback over. You know, we just happen to have better personnel in this instance. You know, our free safety's running. Okay, they're double teaming our linebacker for the QB situation. But because we have great defensive line play on the inside, it makes it pitch it right away. So our outside linebacker can react to it. Here we have motion. Okay, we start on cover eight. We get motion to the slot side. We're going to check cloud. Okay, they're going to run a belly play. Here's an instance where our linebacker, okay, sees an open window, hangs in there, and plays the belly. Now there's a good example of our nose guard, our one technique, defending that block, that double, and turning his butt towards his pressure key. Being the visual key, turn the butt towards the visual key, and maintaining that gap relationship. And then we kind of clog it up with our fullback with a good press technique. They're in hawk, we're in cover eight. He's going to go motion the wing, so we're going to stay cover eight. Free safety now is reading number two. You can see he's locked on as his vertical by number two. Vertical by number two, take it. Outside linebacker, we're in cover eight. Number two goes out, he's mine, man to man. Corner playing his deep half. The situation where we don't have a good play by our outside linebacker. You know, he's kind of caught. Two's going vertical. That's his read, two's going vertical. He should be underneath number one. He's not there fast enough. He's kind of hanging on number two, which is a common mistake for that linebacker to hang on two vertical. He should be underneath number one. Kind of gets a weak throw, the corner has a good converge. Okay, here they shift, okay? They start out in the hawk formation. They shift to brown wing. We're in cover eight, okay? Cover eight rules. Now they zip across motion, zip motion across to a slot. Okay, again, we want to be in eight cloud versus a slot formation. So here we are. This is perfect coverage. This is perfect cloud coverage here. Our corner knows what number two is doing. He syncs with number two. Our strike plays great seam coverage. And we're syncing with this tight end. Perfect coverage here. Now we have a rollout. And remember what we talked about. We're going to secondary contain with the play side linebacker on rollout. Here's a situation where he comes. Gets the sack on play side rollout. Motions across, we're going to cloud. You can see our people changing, but the key thing is here is the whip staying backside. Okay, they run the Sally play on us. Get a defensive tackle, does a great job working that and spinning off to the inside on the Sally. Both middle linebackers in on a tackle on a Sally play. 559, here we are. We get in motion. We check from cover eight to eight cloud. Everybody does a great job of their responsibilities. Here we have option. Let's take a look at it. We have a real heavy five. You know what that's doing? Is that because he's so heavy, they're sending this guy onto our inside linebacker because he just can't get down because we're nice and heavy over there. Always good to have two on the quarterback. And again, if they're sending him on there and they're down blocking, nobody's blocking our defensive end, which is going to make the pitch go real early. Okay, then we have people running to the pitch. We have somebody on the quarterback because they refuse to block our end. It's a great, great pursuit, outside in player, staying outside, and an inside out player. Look at how they work together. Great job on option football. Motion across, check to eight cloud. I like this one because it's seam player in eight cloud. Corner does a good job. Look at our strike here, doing a very nice job in the seam. Real hard to do, to keep nice and patient to stay in that seam. We've got an end doing a great job pulling it up. Linebacker would be secondary containing. Backside linebacker overlap and take his hole. Get outside linebacker, makes a one-handed grab here. Got good coverage over the top of it. Makes a play, now go block somebody downfield. Okay, hawk formation. They're motioning to the wing side. When we go motion to the wing side, we are in cover eight. Okay, we have our outside linebacker in a situation. Now during the game, they felt they wanted to move back a little bit more. Okay, linebackers are at a good depth. Looks very good. Okay, our corners in good alignment. Our free safety is over here in the middle of the field. They're going to go formation, motion to brown wing. We're going to go cover eight. We've got a belly fold play. Here's a defensive end doing a terrific job. Gets a down block. That's what we're talking about. You get a down block. He's reading that. That's his visual key. He doesn't worry about his pressure key. Visual key, come and blow up the pulling guard. Excellent job. Linebacker, great steps. Scrapes right outside, right nice and tight off of that seven technique. And he's an inside-out player. This is terrific defense by these three. They start in a 3-1 set, so we're already determined we're going to be Cloud. All right, we have our corner up. They have three receivers this side. Even if he motions, we're going to stick Cloud. Motion to the backfield, we're still Cloud. All right, we have our corner, our seam player, our free safety. Linebacker does a good job. I would have liked to see a little bit more contact here from people getting crossing routes. You have a situation where you converge on the ball, make plays happen. Get our defensive linemen some picks. Here we go. We have they shift to brown wing, zip across. We go back to Cloud. You see three different changes here. All right, nobody moving across though. We have cover eight. They shift, check the eight Cloud. It's the belly pass. As we had said, linebacker gets play action to him. You go. Turns into a blitz. The linebacker away. Take the hole. Take the hole. Okay, our corner does a great job here with the flat route. Our safety's on the deep route. Got turned around a little bit. Good job of secondary containing. One of the things, I just want to make a point on this play. Now, they started going over. You have to be aware, teach your players about people that are eligible when you're facing the wing T team. Now, we strongly go over the week that this person is a dead football player. Okay, he's being covered up. This is a banded formation to us. We make our players aware he's an eligible player. He would be an eligible player. He's dead. When they come out line of scrimmage, we point them out, say dead, 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 so we don't get confused. We notify the officials we're making this call before a game. Another thing that we look at, and then this formation, I believe we had cover eight checked already to eight Cloud versus this banded formation. If we see a silly split, okay, if we see them trying to widen this out, okay, we do not want to widen our alignment. We want to line up on ghost people. Here we have a linebacker that says we have a gap. That's a silly split. It's just a big gap. We allow them to get in that gap and go and turn into a blitz. There you can see he's pointing. He sees a silly split. He wants to go. Okay, here we are in Hawk. We're in eight. They motion. We go to eight Cloud. One thing that I like on this play, okay, is our backside corner. We talked about that backside corner being a deep half player. Our outside linebacker does a great job of just, you know, covering up this tight end. We say sync with the tight end. That allows our corner to help out on the play side routes. Here you can see our backside corner helping out on the backside post route. Okay, and you get great collisions there on the backside corner. I think when defending the wing T, again, you have to treat it as a philosophy and not as a weekly game plan. And just remember when you talk to your players, the teaching progression that you go through in teaching the wing T, chalk it, talk it, and walk it.